That one's squirting away. It's brought up the 250 for Australia. 252 just for one.
Four more runs added to take the Australians on to 256 for one at the close of play. A late close because of the rain delays early on, around about a 7 o'clock finish. Elliot 66, Bob a good one from Croft. Taylor 108 not out, wonderful to see. And Blewett 61 not out, played very well indeed even though he has a knee injury. 21 extras, 256 for one. Now the bowling figures for England. Goff, I thought, was outstanding today. 19 overs, 6 maidens, none for 53. There's no justice in the world. Not in the bowling world anyway. Malcolm, none for 25. Croft, 22 overs, 6 maidens, 1 for 70. He might have been slightly on the wrong line when he was bowling out there today. And Carrick, none for 41 from 16 overs, 3 maidens. No great amount of luck for him. He bowled some wonderful deliveries without any success. And Elam, 13 overs, 2 maidens, and no wicket for 50. Now, the state of play after 3 days, the Australians 118 bundled out for that low score, and then 256 for one, England 478 for nine declared. Australia 104 runs behind at the moment. And
Moviedrome presents a British network television premiere. Moviedrome presents a double bill of Machines Gone Mad.
What do you want?
Yul Brynner is Robo Cowboy in Michael Crichton's Westworld.
What's his problem?
He got shot up today.
Hell hath no fury like a robot scorned.
Draw.
Oh my God.
Shut down immediately. Cut the robot power. And I'm responding.
At 11:45, it's Woman Against Automaton.
I am important.
Demon Seed, starring Julie Christie.
Stop and listen. You are malfunctioning.
All that I need to understand, Mrs. Harris, is your body.
You're not telling me what you want.
A child.
Mad Bad Machines. Moviedrome next Sunday from 10:15 on BBC Two.
You two are getting on a lot better now.
Call me sentimental, but he was a mate when it mattered.
The day of reckoning draws near for Anna.
If things have been a little touchy between you since your tenancy vote, should let it go.
It's time to face the truth about Miles.
What is this, Anna?
He didn't vote for me.
And Sarah.
We could be a good team.
Oh, I think so.
I mean professionally.
I think we could be more than that.
I'm flattered,
but I've never...
I don't know until you've tried.
This Life, Thursday at 9:30 on BBC Two.
The battle for the Ashes now on BBC Two. Highlights of day four from Edgbaston.
When Mark Taylor was preparing in the nets yesterday, many people thought he was about to play one of his most important test innings as Australian captain. Statistically, things didn't look too good for him. They certainly weren't looking any better for his side either as he and Matthew Elliott emerged to begin their second innings. The Australians languished 360 behind England, but then we saw one of the most remarkable personal fightbacks in test history as Taylor battled his way out of trouble with a defiant, unbeaten century. He picked up plenty of bruises on the way as well from Carrick and Goff and the others. He took his side to 256 for one by the close and certainly restored some hope of saving the game. Well, welcome to the highlights of the fourth day. It was a great day yesterday. We've had three terrific days so far with fluctuating cricket and some wonderful stuff as well. And the Australians have been given a lifeline by Mark Taylor. Just a question of whether they can all grab it. They have one bonus that Mark Waugh is out of hospital. He was discharged this morning and will bat down the order a little bit. And this is the way the Australian scorecard looked. Matthew Elliott as the man out is bowled by Croft for 66. I thought Croft looked pretty good yesterday. He bowled one or two indifferent overs, but he's a newcomer on the test scene. He's only played a handful of games, and I thought he looked okay, and he might play a part in this match before it's over. Taylor, 108 not out. Absolutely wonderful to see. And Greg Blewett, 61 not out. 21 extras, 256 for one. Now, the bowling figures. England bowlers struggled a little bit yesterday. Croft, I thought, with that wicket, deserved it. Goff, none for 53. Malcolm, none for 25. And Caddick, none for 41. Wasn't quite the force of the first innings. Elam, 13 overs, two maidens, and none for 50. And that's the state of play on this fourth morning. The Australians, 104 behind, 256 for one. And Greg Blewett in terrific form. Well, one of the features yesterday, or one of the lack of features, was the fact the ball didn't swing very much. The thing that caught my eye, though, was that Robert Croft managed to get a few to turn. He's drifting the ball and spinning it as well. That could be very interesting as the game goes on. Here's Geoffrey Boycott now with his ideas about the pitch.
Yesterday, Robert Croft found the edge of Mark Taylor's bat. It was a ball that pitched very full in the footholes. Now, he didn't do that very often. He kept bowling at Mark Taylor's legs, so did the other bowlers. And I think there's just a little bit for him to bowl into. If he uses these footholes, floats it up, flights it, and entices Taylor to drive through the covers. Remember, he hasn't got one run through the covers off the front foot. And I think Croft's got to tease him. Get it up there, into the footholes, make him do what he doesn't want to do, that's drive. There's still a little bit in the pitch bowling from the pavilion end for the seamers. Caddick bowl well, got a bit of lift. Goff bowl well. So they've got to make the new ball count. So it's got to be a good bowling day for England.
Thanks, Geoffrey. Geoffrey Boycott with his ideas on the pitch and what might happen today. Well, we're going to join it now in the first over. Andrew Caddick is the bowler. England have taken the new ball. Greg Blewett is taking strike. And no runs have been added to the overnight total.
Well bowled, no ball.
And if Greg Blewett's going to play like that, it gives England's bowlers a better chance of getting him out.
And that's where the runs are coming again. Beautifully played, nicely timed, swinging into the pads and flicked away on the leg side. And they run four. That really is first blow to Mark Taylor.
Perfect was that, just didn't carry. Once you get him playing in that area, I think he's still vulnerable because of his footwork.
Just dropping short and then rolling.
Down the leg side, bread and butter shot.
And that's four runs. You see Mark Taylor just leaned on that, let the ball come onto the pads and just leaned it through mid-wicket. Well, he's beaten by speed there, but he's always got an eye for that hook shot.
That's all right from Devon. He won't worry about that. He'd be delighted to see Greg Blewett hooking.
There's the gully. That's where the ball normally goes when something's dropped in short and the batsman fends it away. They're from Headingley.
Give up, you Welshman.
Good shot into the gap, and the outfielder still running fast there. Ball races away from Robert Croft, and that's four runs. That's well played. It's worth the try from Devon Malcolm, but it is a shot that Greg Blewett plays particularly well. He has a real minimum of movement. It's So the 150 partnership comes up with a splendid drive from Greg Blewett. Beautifully played.
That's not going to do him any harm. It was a very good shot. Jeez, that's a beauty. The first one he hit a couple of overs ago was a cracking shot.
This man's a very good player of the pull shot.
It's a beautiful stroke once again. Blewett was reeling the ball all over the park today. Glorious shot. He's done it again. That's a beauty. Well, Goff's looking for the swing, and Blewett has matched him with two lovely drives, one through cover and the other one just past the left hand of a man at extra cover. Mark Waugh in the Australian dressing room.
Mark Taylor has been so good off his pads right from the start of his innings.
And that's it. Very good square drive. Might not have come completely off the middle, but it is a brilliant 100 from Greg Blewett. It was a thoroughly good innings. Dashing and attractive and very, very entertaining all the way through. Just the sort of counter-attack you need.
Not out is the answer. Although there was a little bit of drift here, I don't think this has done enough to come back. Might have to hurry a bit. Lovely piece of work from Robert Croft. But it was nicely judged. That's glorious. He doesn't hold back, Greg Blewett. Whenever the ball's up there to be hit, he does so with a real flourish. Painful. Just into the midriff. We haven't seen too many deliveries misbehave from this pavilion end since England started bowling for the second time. That's got him. That's worked. And for once, that little tuck away on the onside, this time against the spin, has failed to do the trick for Mark Taylor.
I thought Robert Croft earned this wicket. Eighth ball is bowled round that off stump into the footholes. See, that's outside off stump, quite away. Look where Alex Stewart was going to take it. And Taylor's trying to work him. I said that once you don't give him anything on his pads, then he's got to do something different. He wasn't prepared to cover drive. He's trying to work it from way outside off stump, against the spin, from the footholes.
Well, what a wonderful response to his critics. 327 for 2. Day four means war.
Has gone at a tremendous rate off the bat. He's played some glorious shots today, Greg Blewett. Nothing all that wrong with that delivery. Looked as though it was moving away a little bit from Blewett. Malcolm has saved it. Down that area, he took a very good catch to end the Australian innings, and now he's saved a couple of runs. Well, it was almost the in-swingy or reverse-swinging Yorker, but not quite.
It was a very good delivery. I think probably only could have been combated by a man who's seen the ball as well as Greg Blewett. Well, that was the one where he wanted the big turner, but it didn't deviate all that much.
And he's just strayed a bit too far towards leg stump there. It's a lovely exhibition of stroke play from Greg Blewett.
Darren Goff is finding out that you don't have to miss by much to get punished by Greg Blewett. Well, Lady Luck hasn't been a close friend for Darren Goff in this innings.
Malcolm got one to hit him on the hand here.
Balls. Not out. It was a very good Yorker length. Plenty of pace in that.
Good over from Devon there. Wrapped the bat for Steve Waugh on the hand. Got one through his defence.
Should be out. Eventually Steve Buckner, just having pondered his decision, raises the finger. That was very good bowling from Robert Croft. Greg Blewett was on his way down but didn't reach it. Couldn't control the ball once he just tried to defend. And Mark Butcher at silly point. Taking what is a very simple catch under these circumstances. So the end of Greg Blewett, a very fine innings out of 125.
That's it. A bit of fire and a bit of pace. Just one or two around the lug holes. That's what England want from him now.
This is genuine pace. Signalled by Peter Willey. Oh. Well, Steve Waugh didn't know what was going on there. Trying just to tick it away down the leg side. And I think we'll see here that he's actually very, very lucky indeed to survive. It's caught up in the pads first, then in the spin has taken it back onto the stump. Croft will enjoy this spell. Michael Bevan might prefer to be at this end, but there are problems for the left-hander. This is turned and bounced. Just that bit extra.
But, Steve Waugh's not a man to give in easily. He may play a miss a little bit, but he's a tough character. Always have great respect for him. Problem. That's what you expect on the fourth and fifth day of a test match pitch. Spinners shouldn't run through a team and get sort of 5 for 30, but they should make a contribution.
Oh. That's vicious. Plenty of pace, very awkward height for Steve Waugh. He survives. He'll live to fight on.
Good shot, beautifully played. Lovely footwork and a real clean clip of the bat there. Just look at that timing and the speed of the outfield. That's a fine shot too. Actually, it's a better bowling from Croft, but it's gone away for four. At least he made Bevan play to the offside. I mean, that's where the fielders are. That's where he hopes to get that little turn out of the footmarks there, but it's a super, super shot. That's a good shot. Long half volley that one, and Bevan didn't mistake it. Good swing of the bat. And that's four runs. It's been true of the match right the way through that any batsman who's hit a space with a good firm clip of the bat finds himself with a boundary. Well, that's four more. Beautifully played outside the off stump. That must have come off the... Oh, big... And called for the third umpire. Tremendous throw, that. What appeared to happen is Bevan played the ball onto the boot of Butcher, which ball ricocheted out into the onside. Michael Bevan went, appeared to have plenty of time to come back, but there was a direct hit. In. No margin for error. Catch it, the sound went up. Must have been a bat pad, but it went square, just behind square on the offside. And that's in the air, and that is out, and he's got Bevan. Beautiful bowling, absolutely by design, no doubt about that. Put bags into it, got that little bit of lift.
Aaron Goff just short of a length, always climbing, but Michael Bevan pushing at it. Once again, the hand's just a touch too low, and the ball flying off the shoulder of the bat.
So the fourth wicket goes at 393. Mark Waugh is the incoming batsman. Fine shot. Again, Croft drags it down, pushes it through, and that's very simple stuff for Steve Waugh. Well, bowl, that's out. Just the length. Darren Goff has done it again. That length just short of a good length. And a little bit of help from the wicket. But that must not take away from the real effort that went into that from Darren Goff. And what a big prize. Mark Waugh gets out. 399 for five. Alex Stewart, the catcher.
New batsman is Ian Healy.
Come on, come on, come on!
Come on, shout there was from Robert Croft trying to keep Steve Waugh away from the strike. That's pretty well done from Goff.
Well, there might be quite a bit of booing there from the public who want to see some action and play, but I think that's a fair decision, actually. It's quite murky, and I wouldn't be surprised if we got a few drops of rain.
A Healy has got that away behind point. It's one of his favourite shots. Might not have come right off the meat of the bat, but it certainly went fast enough. And there's another one now gone out towards square leg. The outfield will be a bit slower because of the rain. And Healy will get three there. He's looking for a fourth, but Steve Waugh isn't. Great delivery. He's bowled beautifully. Bowled wonderfully well yesterday. He's come on today and he's just tried so desperately to break through. He's done it twice. The outside off stump, I would imagine, playing the stroke in that fashion.
Well, it's causing problems, is Darren Goff, but good stride forward here by Ian Healy. Got out there.
There's no third man, and that's four.
Yep.
That's a good stroke. The outfield will be damp. It'll slow it up, but not enough that the fielder might be able to catch it. That's a good shot from Healy. Yeah. Didn't quite time that, but it's going to the fast part of the ground. It fairly races away down there on the, well, that's the eastern side of the ground. That's out. Unless he got a touch on that. That was absolutely plumb, I reckon, and it'll show up on the replay. Steve Waugh looked to me to be right across on his stumps from his normal stance position.
Well, that's good bowling from Darren Goff. He's kept his spirit up, he's kept on coming at the batsman. Been jolly hard work, but he's bowled so straight. And I don't think there's any doubt about that, that's out.
The batsman is Shane Warne. That's well bowled. Warne got it away, so it's a nice shot as well. But it was very well bowled. Meant to be the in-swinging Yorker. Almost got it through.
Well, that one flies away off the top edge, but he does play the shot well. Bit of luck, the margin of error is so small, really. It's either a thick top edge which flies away like that, or it's a little nick that goes to the keeper. Oh, well bowled, that was lively.
A catch!
Oh. Well, he tried the big hit, there was no one out of deep mid wicket, but the ball skewered off past Butcher, who was at Silly Point, and the arms went up again. Oh, well, he was always going for the gap, but there was a chance. Devon Malcolm once threatened it, but never made it. Oh, that's a big shot. It's a big hit. Dropped short, perfectly picked up, well spotted immediately, and that's four runs. And that's short and it's whacked away again, and that's not good bowling by Elam, but fine batting by Shane Warne. That's Solanke, a substitute fielder. He's on for Crawley, and that's out. Michael Afton takes a full-blooded cut in the gully. 465 for seven now.
It was a catch well taken by Mike Atherton. Seemed to be hit pretty firmly. It was down low, but he was quickly there and made it look very easy. And that brings Kasprovic to the crease.
And there's another one. The medium pacer Mark Elam has picked two in the one over. Perfectly straightforward catch. Kasprovic has gone. Gone without scoring. Warner's on 24, and now it's going to be a very difficult target to bowl at for the Australians. England have done well. Ended an injured cricketer going out there to take his place with Shane Warne. Bevan will run with him. And if none of the three of them have ever done this before, it could have its comical moments. Got to be out. It'll be interesting to see how this comes up. Right, now Crawley comes around, picks it up. There's problems. Bevan hasn't taken off yet. He is very quick, but I doubt if he's got a chance, really. Yeah, he's gone. He's gone. Very well done. McGrath is at the non-striker's end. Unlikely to be a batting hero. And he's gone. Straight away. Mark Elam has put and bowled Shane Warne. Well, that was quite a collapse for the Australians towards the end there. 5 for 46 they lost, and they finished up with only 477. I reckon they needed at least 510, and they probably really desired something like 560, but it wasn't to be. 477, and England did very well. There's 129 there for Taylor and blew it a lovely innings, and those bowlers undid them. Gough 3 for 123, I thought was superb all the way through the match. Malcolm none for 52, Croft bowled well, 3 for 125. Caddick none for 87, was off form compared with the first innings. And Elam came in and picked up those three late wickets, which made a big difference. 3 for 60 from 15.4 overs and three maidens. Now, this is the way it looked at the start of the England second innings. England needing 118 runs to win. The Australians, that same figure all out in the first innings by coincidence. And then 478 for 9, England in their innings. And the Australian card you've just seen, 477 all out with the purposeful bowling on the right-hand side there. And the two excellent centuries from Taylor and Blewett on the left. Well, we're going to join play now with the first ball of the England innings. McGrath is the bowler and he's bowling to Butcher. 118 needed to win. And four runs straight away. A beautiful stroke from Atherton. 11 off the first over from McGrath.
All or nothing really for Australia. They've got a lot of close fielders up there. There's a ring of catchers. No one at third man.
Better.
Big shouts. He's got him. Well, Mark Butcher is on his way. Kasprovic fighting back. And one Surrey man goes. Another one comes. Alex Stewart. Taking Michael Atherton to 5,000 in Test cricket. Coming back for the second, just for good measure. Oh, sweetly played. Well, the points are being scored in every sense by the England batsman.
Say quite deliberately played over the slip area.
Alex Stewart has shown that he likes to use his feet against Shane Warne. He did so on that occasion.
Well, that's gone at a decent pace off the bat. Beautiful shot. That's a fine shot. Well, that's a good shot. With that ball turned pretty sharply out of the rough. And Alex Stewart has clipped it away brilliantly. Oh, what a beauty. We've seen nothing better than that today, possibly throughout the match. Just a little fend away on the offside and a half century for the England captain. Cracking stroke. And that's it. 119. They only need 118, just one wicket down. Yes, indeed, that was quite a performance. Within 4 days and by 9 wickets. 14 for Butcher before he was LBW. Atherton played some blinding strokes. 57 not out for him. And Alex Stewart, those two old campaigners were there. They're not old people in cricket terms, but old campaigners. And this would have been a wonderful moment for them. 119 for one. The bowling figures, just three used for Australia. McGrath and Kasperwitz each had 42 taken from 7 overs. And Kasperwitz picked up the 1 wicket to fall out of Butcher. Shane Warne, 7.3 overs, no maiden, none for 27, and the winning hit made off him. And that's the way it finished up. England won by 9 wickets. They lead the series 1-0. Bear in mind it's a six-match series, 5 to go. And the Australians, 118 and 477, the big recovery in the second innings, but it wasn't enough. England, 478 for 9 and 119 for 1. That was a terrific performance and a well-merited win. And at the end, when the players came off the field and assembled up on top of the pavilion, there was a presentation to Michael Atherton for being the winning captain in this Cornhill series, and a very good performance he put up as well. I was very impressed with his captaincy all the way through and the way he kept his team at it. Then a presentation to Nasser Hussain for that wonderful 207. He was the player of the match, as indeed he was here on an indifferent pitch last year. After the game, I spoke with England captain Michael Atherton, and David Gower spoke with Australian captain Mark Taylor. Michael, that was a big win. Congratulations. Absolutely terrific to watch.
Yeah, really good game of cricket. It had all sorts for the spectators, and obviously the right result for us.
Indeed it was. The bowlers on the first day?
Yeah, there's a bit of moisture in the pitch, and I think a bit of humid atmosphere made the ball swing. And it was swing as much as seam that did it, and the bowlers pitched the ball up, got the ball in the right places, and we caught our catches.
Well, that first day obviously took everyone by surprise, players and watchers alike. How much was that good bowling, how much was that bad batting?
I think a lot of it was good bowling. I think the English side bowled a very, very good line. There was a bit of swing around and a little bit of seam, but had one of those days where we nicked everything. We didn't really play a lot of bad shots. There wasn't any wild ones. Steve Woy and Healy nicked balls. Mark Waugh bowled and Matthew Elliott bowled. Suggest that was no real big shots, just some good bowling. That's the way it went, but really needed someone to guts it out. Try and make 200, 250, and we've been right in the game.
What about when you were sitting in the dressing room and three quick ones had gone down just after you'd bowled Australia out for 118?
Well, the game was on a kind of knife edge then, and it's great that Nasser Hussain and Graham Thorpe played as well as they did in that situation when the game's kind of hanging in the balance. To play those 200s was terrific.
They've looked good players all the way along since the Australians first saw them together in Trent Bridge in 1993. How would you rate Nasser's innings here compared with last year against India?
The pitch was easier than last year, but the game perhaps didn't quite have the importance of this one, with this being the first of a long Ashes summer. And I thought 207 against Australia here, that's as good as innings as you'll see.
Graham Thorpe?
Well, he's been, he's played virtually all the games since I've been captain, and he's been a real rock in the middle order, a real consistent player, and he's just stringing together now the hundreds that everybody said he should have got before that.
And now the second innings, you started to show as a team better form all around there, so that would have given you encouragement.
Yeah, I think we've been slow on the uptake over here so far. We really haven't hit our straps as yet, but England haven't let us hit our straps either. They've played some very, very good cricket, so we've got some work to do in the next 2 weeks.
Lord's coming up, not so long now, but six test matches in the series in all.
It's a long summer ahead. We've won the first one, we've got the right result here, but we must carry forward this kind of aggressive, positive cricket that we're playing at the moment, this confidence, and carry it through to the next five games.
Looks good at the moment. Congratulations and thank you very much.
Thank you.
From my point of view, I almost prefer to get ducks and win test matches. It's much more fun as a captain, but yeah, it's nice to make a few myself. But as I said, the result is still not the way I'd like it.
Well, Mark Taylor knows what has to be done. Whether it can be done by the time the Lord's Test comes up is entirely another matter. And now with their ideas on the match, and in particular on the last day, here's Ian Chappell and with him Geoffrey Boycott.
Ian, England's victory, very good, I thought, was made possible because they bowled Australia out for 118 and then Thorpe and Hussain piled on a big score.
Yes, I mean, that's the way Australia has been beating England in this country for the last couple of tours. And it was a very good victory to England, morale boosting and good to get one up in the series. But I think there were also some positive signs for Australia and they can look forward to Lord's with some sort of hope.
What about the Australian bowling, though? Because I thought that Glenn McGrath and Shane Warne have been your two big wicket takers the last couple of years. Shane's a great bowler. But neither he nor Glenn McGrath looked very penetrating in this test match. Must be a little bit of a worry.
I think there were some good signs in the second innings with Shane Warne. Right. I think there was a couple of things there that were good. Glenn McGrath was going the other way in the second innings. I think he's way down on confidence. They've got to get him some wickets before the Lord's test.
So all in all pluses for England. Good victory. And one or two things for Australia to work on for the Lord's Test match.
Yes, Australia outplayed in the first one, but watch out.
A firm and concise summing up there of this first Test match at Edgbaston, the first in a series of six games in the 1997 Ashes battle. Now, coming up at Lord's, we have the game which is the second Cornhill Insurance Test match. That's 19-23 June, live coverage on BBC television, and that should be an absolute beauty. The first game itself, well, it was a triumph for England. They carried most of the honours all the way through. The Australians fought back, but they weren't good enough in the end. It was a tremendous victory for England. Full congratulations to them. And from Edgbaston, for the moment, it's goodbye.